put your hands together for us as she comes before us to share the word of the Lord. Amen.
Ooh, amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Lord. To God be the glory. Hallelujah. I give honor to the risen Savior. Without him, I am nothing, but through him, I can do all things. I certainly give honor to our senior pastor, Reverend Curtis W. Bell Jr., and I am grateful for the opportunity to share the word today. Thank you, Pastor. I bless the Lord for our First Lady, Diana Bell, and I celebrate you not just on Tuesday, hallelujah, but every day throughout the year. I thank God for the powerful preachers that serve on the ministerial staff of Clearview Baptist Church. It is a privilege to work and minister and serve alongside each of you. To all the officers, members, and visitors who didn't leave the Zoom meeting when they found out that somebody else was preaching instead of Pastor today, I thank God for you. And last but not least, I'm certainly grateful for the prayers and support of my family, my bestie, my sorors, and my friends who are joining us today. I love you. There is a word from the Lord, and I thank Reverend Weathers for reading the scripture today. By way of refresher, I'm just going to put my kickstand down at Genesis chapter 50, verse 20, also in the New Living Translation. Genesis 50, verse 20 reads, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it all for good. He brought me to this position so I could save the lives of many people." Today, on this last day in February, as we close out the last Sunday of Black History Month, and as I adorn my African-influenced garb, at least from the waist up, if I had to title my brief time with you today, I would simply call it, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Let us pray. Father, we exalt you, we lift you up, and we magnify you, because this is still the day that you have made, and we're rejoicing and being glad in it. God, I pray right now, Lord, that you will just show yourself strong and mighty. Lord, I studied and I prayed, but I need you to provide the increase. God, I pray that you cause this body to line up with what you purposed it to do, that is to preach and teach this gospel. I ask that you prepare the ears of those who are going to hear. And I pray, God, that your word will go forth with power and demonstration. I pray that anybody who does not know you today and the pardon of their sins will come and say, yes, I want to get to know you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Even though it's Black History Month, we are also on the cusp of Women's History Month as well. And I just want to share a little bit about Maya Angelou, who was born Marguerite Johnson on April 4th in 1928 in St. Louis, Missouri. After her parents' marriage ended, she and her brother Bailey, who gave her the name Maya, were sent to live with their grandmother. And although her grandmother helped her develop her pride and her self-confidence, Maya Angelou was devastated when she was raped at the age of 8 by her mother's boyfriend. After she testified against the man, several of her uncles beat him to death. Believing that she had caused the man's death by speaking his name, a young Maya Angelou didn't utter a single word for a whole 5 years. By the age of 16, Maya Angelou had given birth to a son, and while still in high school, she became the very first ever African-American streetcar conductor in San Francisco, California. And later in her early 20s, she married a Greek sailor, but that union did not last very long. Angelou studied drama and dance and went on to a career in theater. She appeared in Porgy and Bess and Cabaret for Freedom, which she co-wrote, allowing her to give performances in 22 countries. She also lived in Accra, Ghana, contributing to the articles of the Ghanaian Times. And she was also, she lived in Cairo, Egypt, and she was the editor of the Arab Observer. After returning to the United States, civil rights leader, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. requested that she serve as Northern coordinator for the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, giving her a distinct voice for civil rights and social justice. But on the other side of this same Maya wrote an autobiographical work like I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings and Gathered Together in My Name and The Heart of a Woman and All God's Children Need Traveling Shoes and a children's book called Kofi and His Magic. On the other side of this, she wrote, "Just Give Me a Cool Drink of Water Before I Die" and "Oh, Pray My Wings Are Gonna Fit Me Well" and one of her most famous writings, "I Still and Still I Rise." On the other side of this, she wrote, "Shaker, why don't you sing? And life doesn't frighten me. Souls look back and wonder, and I shall not be moved." Angelou's poetry received praise for discussing social and political issues that are important to African Americans. For example, she recited her work on the Pulse of Mourning at the 1993 inauguration of President Bill Clinton, calling for a new national commitment to unity and social improvement. After receiving numerous awards for her work, including nominations for a National Book Award and Pulitzer Prize and Tony Award nominations, and after serving on several presidential commissions, in a moment of reflection on how it started versus how it's going, Maya Angelou paused to put together a collection of reflective essays in a book called Wouldn't Take Nothing for My Journey Now. And that's exactly where we find Joseph in today's scripture reading. Joseph puts his entire life in perspective in the final chapter of Genesis. You know the story. During the height of a terrible famine, after Joseph leveled up, his brothers humbly come before him and bow down, just as he had predicted decades earlier. But instead of using his enormous power to punish them, he says, "You meant it for evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about this day to save many people." Joseph could have had an "I told you" spirit. Joseph could have had a "I gotta have the last word" spirit. Joseph could have had the "gag is on you" spirit. Joseph could have possessed a na-na-na-na-na spirit. Sister Danielle Thomas, AKA DJ Honest D, Joseph could have been cocky as in his younger years and played the following soundtrack: Kool Moe Dee's "How You Like Me Now," or Drake "Started From the Bottom, Now I'm Here," or one of my Aunt Nan's favorite songs by Fat Joe and Remy Ma, "Nothing Can Stop Me, I'm All the Way Up." But that's not what Joseph did. But now that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers became fearful, and now Joseph will show his anger and pay us back, is what his brothers thought he would do. But after burying his father, Joseph went back to Egypt. All his brothers who had come with him to bury his father returned with him. And after the funeral, Joseph's brother talked among themselves. And they said, "What if Joseph is carrying a grudge and decides to pay us back for all the wrong we did to him?" So they sent a message to Joseph, the servants of the God, their father. These words were wonderfully chosen when they said them. Joseph said, "I forgive you." And when Joseph received the message, he broke down and wept. The father commanded him to do so. He knew on his inside that he had to forgive his brothers. Some think that the brothers made up this story about the father telling him to forgive your brothers. But so they sent Joseph a message before his death that his father gave him this command: "Tell Joseph, forgive your brother's sins and all that wrongdoing, and that they treat you very badly. Will you do it? Will you forgive the sins of the servants of your father?" But when Joseph received their message, he just wept. He wept because he had already forgiven them. Now that Joseph is leveled up and his brothers are bowing down, the brothers then went in person to him. They threw themselves on the ground before him and said, "We'll be your slaves." The same brothers that betrayed him were now going to bow down to him. The same people that abandoned him now admired him. The same people that deceived him now delight in him. The same brothers that forsake him now need a favor from him. The same brothers that deserted him now defer to him. The same brothers that walked out on him now worship him. The same brothers that left him for dead need him to live. But Joseph replied with a rhetorical question. He says, "Don't be afraid of me. Am I God that I can punish you? Am I in the place of God?" See, Joseph's words were rhetorical. They could either be understood as a question or even as a proposition. You know, he wanted to know, "How should I take any further notice of your transgression?" In other words, "I'm already done with it. I'm already over it." Therefore, he spoke comfortably to them, telling them that he attributed the whole business to the particular providence of God rather than any ill will towards them or any malice in them. See, in permitting him to do that, and permitting him to be brought back to Egypt, look at what God did. God had graciously saved their lives. That's the way Joseph saw it. God had honored him by raising him up to be over the distribution of all the food and resources toward many people. How could Joseph trip and be made mad about what happened? He says, "Am I in the place of God?" These words may be understood as a question or not. "How should I take notice of your transgression?" Joseph, the overconfident younger Joseph, was the son of Jacob. Joseph was number 11 out of 12 boys. Joseph started off as his daddy's favorite. His pops loved him so much that he gave Joseph a beautiful coat of many colors. Joseph, in his early years, had dreamed about his 10 older brothers bowing down to him, but he was bold enough to tell them about it. Joseph, whose older brothers were jealous of him, his brothers were such haters that they sold him off into slavery when he was just 17 years old. Joseph's brothers conspired against him and snatched him out of the life he knew, a life where he was covered and loved by his father, where he was favored and living well. His own kinfolk pushed him from where his daddy was and plucked him out of that love and care and put him in a messed up situation. He was sold into slavery. He was betrayed by his blood and deserted by his family. At age 18, while in captivity, he was exposed to sexual sin and wrongly accused of adultery with Potiphar's wife. But he wouldn't trade nothing for his journey now. He was punished for doing the right thing. From age 18 through age 27, he went to prison and served hard time in a lengthy bid. At age 28, he interprets dreams for Pharaoh's brother and butler and baker, which led to a position interpreting dreams for Pharaoh himself at age 29. You see, it was all working together for his good. At 30 years old, he was appointed to be an overseer. Joseph had two sons, one named Ephraim and the other one named Manasseh, meaning God has made me forget entirely my troubles and my father's house. Jacob, Joseph's father, adopted Joseph's two sons to share in Jacob's inheritance equally with Jacob's own sons. So his boys were now being raised like his brothers. But in his 30s, Joseph experienced years of plenty. And all the while, God was preparing him for the subsequent years of famine. At 39, the very brothers who betrayed him had to comfort him for grain. And some years later, Joseph's father died. Joseph had been through some things, but he wouldn't trade nothing for his journey now. Despite it all, he said, "Don't be afraid. I'll continue to take care of you and your children." So he assured them by speaking to them kindly. He said, "Don't be afraid. I will take care of you and your children." He assured them by speaking to them from heart to heart. That was an ugly chapter in the book, but it wasn't the end of his story. I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. And throughout the Bible, we see this time and time again. What was meant for evil was turned into good. Come here, Moses. Moses is called by God to lead his people from Egypt to the promised land. A very reluctant people, feeling unworthy of the call, Moses accepts the task. Moses' story begins in Egypt with the persecution of newborn Hebrew males and Pharaoh's daughter discovering the infant Moses in the River Nile. Moses saw an Egyptian being beat by a Hebrew slave and he killed him. Moses, who had to look cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs as he was standing there talking to a burning bush. But on the other side of this same murdering Moses was used by God to tell Pharaoh, "Let my people go." On the other side of this, God uses Moses to part the Red Sea and perform some other miracles. On the other side of this, Moses had to have some face time with God. He was allowed to come into God's presence. And when he came back with his face glowing, people were shook when they saw him. On the other side of this, Moses was used by God to record the Ten Commandments. And that same stuttering, stammering Moses was called to lead this stiff-necked, ungrateful, complaining people into a promised land that he wouldn't even get to see. But if I asked Moses for a message, he would say to me, he wouldn't trade nothing for his journey now. Come here, Israelites. They complained about quail. They complained about manna. They complained about their shoes. They complained about how long. They complained about how far. They complained about how wide. They complained about man. They complained about God. They complained about slavery. They complained about freedom. They were building idols and worshiping God. They were wanderers for 40 years. But on the other side of this, their children entered the promised land, which overflowed with milk and honey. And if I could sit down with the Israelite generation that made it in, they would say, "I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now." Come here, David. David was born a shepherd boy. David was Jesse's youngest son, almost overlooked. David, who was anointed to be the future king of Israel. Young David killed the giant Goliath with a slingshot. And this same David, as a king, committed adultery and had a child out of wedlock. David murdered her husband to cover up his sin. David was hated by Saul so much that Saul attempted commissioned to murder him with a javelin. But on the other side of this, David is still known as a man after God's own heart. David is still known as a man that God loves. God, I tell you the truth, on the other side of this, David would have the bloodline through which our beloved Jesus Christ would enter. On the other side of this, if I had a discussion with David about his life story, David would say, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Esther. Esther wasn't raised by her own parents. She was adopted by her cousin Mordecai. She was hiding her Jewish identity while living with the king. She risked her life to have an audience with the king, saying, if I perish, let me perish, but I'm going to see the king. But on the other side of this, Esther's courage would deliver her people and save the Jews from Haman's plot. But if I could have an exchange with Esther, I'd simply talk to her and ask her, and I bet she would tell me, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Job. Job was a wealthy man living in a land called Uz. Job had a large family and expensive flocks. Job, whom Satan challenges God that if I give him permission to punish this man, Job was expected to turn and curse God. Job, whom God allowed Satan to torment. Job, who took the test to a bold claim, lost everything that he had. Job lost his wife. Job lost his family. All Job's money was gone. But on the other side of this, he did not lose his life. He got back double for his trouble. He did not curse God. And in spite of it all, if I could just consult Brother Job, he would simply tell me, after all he's been through, his answer would still be, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Naomi. After she gets there, she loses her husband. All her sons have died. Her daughter-in-law, Orpah, has left her. She changed her name, saying, call me Mara because I'm bitter. But on the other side of this, there was a beautiful relationship with the daughter-in-law who remained. She was not left alone. On the other side of this, she discovered the importance of family and loyalty and humility. And if I could have a talk with Mother Naomi, she'd say something like this. I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Ruth. She worshiped pagan gods in Moab. She was a young widow in a land that was not her own. She was cast into the wilderness, but she worked in the field. Glory to God. But on the other side of this, she was chosen by a wealthy man, Boaz, and he gave her extra. And on the other side of this, she sees the providence of God and knows him as Kinsman Redeemer. So if I had a question with Ruth or a conversation with Ruth on today, she'd simply say, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Somebody said it's still Black History Month. Come here, Harriet Tubman. Harriet Tubman, an escaped enslaved woman. Harriet Tubman, who became a conductor on the Underground Railroad. Harriet Tubman, leading enslaved people to freedom before the Civil War. Harriet Tubman, all the while carrying a bounty on her head. Harriet Tubman, who went back for her own family, but they wouldn't come with her. Harriet Tubman, the nurse. Harriet Tubman, the union spy. Harriet Tubman, the women's suffrage supporter. Harriet Tubman, codenamed Moses. Harriet Tubman, nicknamed the conductor. Harriet Tubman, who was illiterate all of her life. Harriet Tubman, who suffered from narcolepsy. But on the other side of this, she never lost a slave. She cured dysentery. She was the first woman to lead a combat assault. On the other side of this, she's about to see her face on the $20 bill. But if I could talk to Evangelist Harriet, I asked her about her story, she would simply say this, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Martin. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., birth name Michael, not Martin. Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. entered college at the age of 15. He received his doctorate in systemic theology. King's most famous oration, I Have a Dream, was not his first one at the Lincoln Memorial. King was in prison nearly 30 times. King narrowly escaped an assassination attempt about a decade before his actual death. King was stabbed so close to the tip of the blade was at the edge of his aorta, the main artery, that if he would sneeze, he would have died. Martin Luther King's house was bombed. Dogs were sicked on him. Water hoses tried to drown him. Nights away from his family. Dr. King gave his very life for the cause. But on the other side of this, He promoted nonviolent tactics to achieve civil rights. He led a number of peaceful protests, such as the March on Washington and the Montgomery boycott. He was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, and he changed this entire world. And if I asked Dr. King, would he do it all over again? He'd say, I wouldn't trade nothing.
come here, Barack Hussein Obama. His daddy left him at the age of 2 to study at Harvard University. Later, his parents got divorced. Obama saw his father only one more time in his life, and that was when he was 10 years old. He took a position in 1985 as a community organizer in Chicago's most impoverished far south side. But on the other side of this, he graduated from the school his father left him for, magna cum laude, Harvard University. He was the first African-American to serve as president of the Harvard Law Review. And later on, he was the first to serve as president of the United States of America. And if I had to ask him, would he do it all again? Barack Obama would say, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Kamala. She came from immigrant parents, was bused to Berkeley as part of a desegregation program. Her parents were divorced. She graduated from a historically black college, the Howard University. She went to law school on a legal education opportunity program grant. She ran for president, and her old political party didn't choose her for their candidate. She was criticized for her policies and her views. But on the other side of this, she now serves as the 49th vice president of these United States and the first woman, an African American, to do so. But if I could sit down with Madam Vice President and ask her would she change anything, I'm sure her answer would be, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, George Floyd. He lost his mother. He had a troubled past, but he told his daughter that he was going to change the world. And on the other side of this, that's exactly what he did. His death woke up the entire world, including a young generation, and sparked a movement for social justice and some real change, a peaceful protest. And God bless him, he's going to change, put laws into practice. Oh, thank you, Lord. If I could ask him, would he do it again? George Floyd would say, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Colin Kaepernick. He kneeled in protest to police brutality because of the police brutality of people of color. He was banned from the NFL. He couldn't even get a job, even though he's one of the number one players in the league. But on the other side of this, he sparked a movement within the world, including pro athletes, and subsequently changed the nation. If I asked him, would he do it again? Colin Kaepernick would say, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Michael Jordan, cut from the college basketball team. But on the other side of this, he becomes the greatest of all times. Come here, Amanda Gorman. Couldn't even pronounce the letter R. They made fun of her speech impediment. But on the other side of this, she became the youngest poet laureate, and she shared her magical and inspirational poem in front of the entire world and the president of these United States. And she's now a household word. Come here. You know, but we don't have to look very far, because we can always say, come here, Brother Leo Adams. God bless you. He drove the church van on a regular basis. He did it without murmuring and complaining. He made sure that everyone was at Sunday school on time. He served as an usher. He was a good man. But if I could talk to Brother Leo right now, he'd tell me I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Aunt Nan, mother of the church. Faithful missionary, prayer warrior. But if I could talk to my auntie again, she'd tell me I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Brother Mark Smith, faithful servant, often overlooked. I can't even imagine looking up at the booth and not seeing him up there. When I started going through my stuff, I found 32 cards from this brother just to me, my friend Mark. First to open up the church, first to be there, last to leave it, just to shut it down. But if I could have just one more conversation with my friend, he'd simply say this, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Marvin Mixon, Giants fan, love to cook, always serving, loved his wife. On the other side of this, there's some folks that'll never know a love like you all had. Hallelujah. But if we asked him to do it all again, he'd say, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Sister Vicky Brown. I can't just see her coming in the side door with her grandchildren in tow. Sometimes she would be so happy in a wheelchair that I thought she would get up and walk her. But if we asked Sister Vicky Brown, would she do it all again? She'd say, I trade nothing for my journey now. Hallelujah. Come here, Sister Toni Murphy. I can hear her hallelujah stomp in the balcony right now. Evangelist to those who are struggling with addiction. She did this on her own time. But if she had to do it all over again, she'd say, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. Come here, Deaconess Patricia Porterfield. Surgery after surgery. Smile on her face. Encouraging others. before she passed, she was praising and worshiping the Lord. Hallelujah. I could go on and on, but I know she wouldn't trade anything for her journey now. All we have to do is look back over our own lives. Truth be told, some of us have had some ugly chapters, but that's not the whole book. Started from the bottom, fell to the top. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Bank account on 4 digits one day, and then on 40 cents the next day. Sitting in the bins one day. Next day, you're taking the bus. We've all been through some things, but the reality is we wouldn't trade nothing for our journey now. The abuse, on the other side of that abuse was your anointing. On the other side of the depression is deliverance. That neglect was necessary. That breakup on the other side was breakthrough. On the other side of that rape was revelation. On the other side of molestation was a miracle. On the other side of that hurt was healing. On the other side of the gossip was God's grace. On the other side, don't let 2020 fool you. Hallelujah. Don't you let 2020 fool you. Because on the other side of COVID was community. We came by together like never before. On the other side of pandemic was promise. On the other side of Trump was triumph. Oh, hallelujah. I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. You see, Joseph knew that what they meant for evil, God meant for good. Joseph knew that the Lord was about to prepare a table in the presence of his enemies. Joseph remembered that the Lord is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Joseph could have revealed himself at any time to his brothers, but he remembered what you do in secret, God will reward you openly for. Joseph was reminded that the humble will be exalted and in due season if they faint not. Joseph was advised that the Lord will be an enemy to your enemies and oppose those who oppose him. Joseph was cautioned to love his enemies and do good to those who hate you and to bless those who curse you and pray for those who mistreat you. Joseph was forewarned not to gloat when your enemies fall. When they stumble, don't let your heart rejoice. Though they rejected him, the way of Joseph's anointing was set up, it brought to mind that the Lord is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. Joseph recalled, fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like grass. Joseph recalled that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up like wings like an eagle. They shall run and not get weary. They shall walk and not faint. Joseph recognized that if you trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding, in all of your ways you acknowledge him, he shall direct your path. Joseph knew not to overcome evil with evil, but to overcome evil with good. Joseph would trade nothing for his journey now because God's grace covered him, and it was sufficient. When I look back over my own life, every hurt, every disappointment, it was all working together for my good and God's glory. You see, I know a man who came down through 40 and two generations. He paid a debt that he did not owe. He was wounded for my transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of my peace is upon him. They tell me that by his stripes, I was healed from COVID-19. He was beaten with a cat of nine tails. He was a crown of thorns was shoved onto his head and into his head. He was spat on. He was mocked. He was called names. He was falsely accused and wrongly convicted. He was despised and rejected. He was separated from his father. He was executed in front of his mother. They hung him high and they stretched him wide. They drew lots for his clothes. They gave him sour wine. He hung on an old rugged cross. They drove nails in his feet and they drove nails in his hand. They pierced him in his side and the blood came trickling down. He hung mad and died. He, even though he knew no sin, he knew we would sin, but he still stayed up on the cross. He knew we would make promises that we couldn't keep. He knew we would talk about one another. He even knew that we would cuss. He knew that we wouldn't always get it right. He knew that we would be a hot mess. He knew that we would have racism and injustice, but yet he died for you and for me. But on the other side of this, just 3 days later, early on a Sunday morning, the stone was rolled away. Yes, Lord. And he got up with all power in his hands just to proclaim that he so loved the world that he would do it over and over and over again. And he wouldn't take nothing for his journey now. What man or man is this that he would lay down his life for his friends? His name is Jesus. Somebody said his mouth is sweetness itself. Somebody said he's altogether lovely. Somebody said he's the rose of Sharon. Somebody said he's a lily among the thorns. Somebody told me he's the fairest of 10,000. Somebody said he's a bright morning star. He called me friend. He's the lover of my soul. He's a lawyer in the courtroom. Trustee Shelley, he's a healer. He makes a way out of no way. He is my refuge and my strength. Brother Steve, he's a doctor in the sick room. Hallelujah. He sticks closer to you than any brother. Deacon Porterfield, he is joy in a time of sorrow. Hallelujah. Pastor Bell, he's a strong tower. Sister Sandy, he's a mother to the motherless. He's a father to the fatherless. And as long as I got King Jesus, I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey now. To God be the glory for the great thing he has done. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.